Yeah.
And in church. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to everyone online and in church to morning worship. I think my microphone's not on.
Can't hear it in.
I'll continue anyway.
Oh, that's better. That's better.
A look at this week's events. First of all, a big thank you to everyone who attended the Murder Mystery Evening last night. The culprit was thankfully apprehended. This Tuesday at 12 o'clock in the day, we have fish in hall. What is this, apart from fish and chips? Well, it's fish stands for food in school holidays, which our church and others in Lowestoft are involved in. The aim of the project is to help families out during the holidays when they aren't getting their funded school meals. And Fish offers a free cooked meal. Please speak to Reverend Sharon for more details. This Friday, we have Summer Cafe at 10 a.m. There's lots of delicious morsels, sweet and savoury, for you to delight in if you'd like to come along. We also have the Graveyard Gardening Group at 10 too. If you want to join in with that, you'd be most welcome. We have also found a pair of reading glasses in the churchyard. Just contact the office if they are yours. We will now begin our service. Loving God, we gather as your people around your word. Fill us with the Holy Spirit as we sing your praises, hear your truth, and ask for your help. We pray that we may know you better and love you more. For your name's sake. Amen. We praise you, O God. We acclaim you as the Lord. All creation worships you, the Father everlasting. To you, all angels, all the powers of heaven, the cherubim and seraphim, sing in endless praise. Holy, 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 Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. We now have our first hymn, opening with Lord of all hopefulness. Please stand.
Thank you.
shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of his glory in the face of Christ. But we have his treasure in earthen vessels to show that the transcendent power belongs to God and not to us. As we acknowledge our human frailty, we call to mind our sins of word, deed and omission, and confess them before God our Father. God our Father, we come to you in sorrow for our sins, for turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives. Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
For behaving just as we wish, without thinking of you, Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
For failing you by what we do and think and say, Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
For letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world around us, Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
For living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son, Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
May the Father forgive us by the death of his Son, and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days.
Amen.
We will now have Psalm 115, 1-13. Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but to your name give glory, because of your mercy and because of your truth. Why should the Gentiles say, where now is their God? But our God is in heaven. He does whatever he pleases. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they do not speak. Eyes they have, but they do not see. They have ears, but they do not hear. Noses they have, but they do not smell. They have hands, but they do not handle. Feet they have, but they do not walk. Nor do they mutter through their throat. Those who make them are like them, so is everyone who trusts in them. O Israel, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. You who fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. The Lord has been mindful of us. He will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless those who fear the Lord, both small and great. Glory to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Now have our Bible reading, please.
He's coming.
Morning. The first reading is from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25, to chapter 5, verse 2. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbour. For we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come into your mouths, but only what is helpful, building others up according to their needs. Let it may be a benefit for those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another. Forgive each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And our second reading is from John 6, verses 35, and then 41 to 51. Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." At this, the Jews then began to grumble about him, because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." They said, "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, 'I came down from heaven'?" "Stop grumbling amongst yourselves," Jesus answered. "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will be taught by God. Everyone who has heard the Father and learned from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that we can look at these passages together this morning. And we ask that you would reveal yourself afresh to us and in us today by the power of your Holy Spirit. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Well, good morning and hello online as well. It's really great to be with you again this week. It really is such a privilege to be with you like this. I came to today's gospel reading and I saw that we are still talking about bread, so I got hungry. This is the second part of Jesus' bread of life saying. So this week is a little bit of a part two to Sharon's talk last week, where Jesus says, "No, you don't need bread like you know it, you need me." That's Jesus, the bread of life. And Sharon encouraged us to recognise who Jesus says he is. The one who satisfies us spiritually and fills our whole lives if we so choose that open, postured response to him. Last week, there seemed in the reading to be a bit of a misunderstanding of what Jesus was saying. It was almost like confusion, because they were focused completely on the physical bread and not what Jesus meant. But today, our reading jumped to verse 41 with what seems to me to be a very different response, almost indignant. The people saying, "Who does this man think he is? He has some nerve telling us he's from heaven. We know full well where he came from." And Jesus was
response seems to suggest that they should know by now how this works. They know the old stories, they know the law and the prophets. God the Father draws us to himself. God wants to have a living relationship with his people. He wants his people to depend on him. That's why the manna was sent daily to Moses and the wandering Israelites. And Jesus is explaining that he has been sent that they might have life. And if they depend on him and the work of salvation achieved for us all through him, they can have eternal life with God. We know now what this work of Jesus was to look like, his ultimate act of loving self-sacrifice. But from the response in verse 41, it doesn't seem as if they're quite willing to understand their need of Jesus. I wonder sometimes if the same is true of me. For us. Sometimes, you know, we're doing quite well actually, we're quite happy with how things are. Things are going okay. So we perhaps lose sight of the grace that God has had with us, accepting us as we are. We lose sight of how far we've come because God has drawn us, or for some of us on occasion dragged us this far. The point here is, we wouldn't really as readily forget that we need food. There might be the occasion that we're so occupied with something else that, you know, is that the time I forgot to eat? Or the meal we had before might have been more than sufficient and you can last a little longer. But eventually the hunger pains would kick in. The body would begin to be limited in what it has the energy to do. And some of us, like myself, might get the hangry, moody reactions that come with a bit of hunger. My family seem to know when I need to eat. We know we need food to sustain us. And Jesus is telling us the eternal life on offer is sustained by trust, belief, and dependence on him. Do we know that we rely on the grace of God? One of the psalms set for today, a bit like the one that was already read to us, is an incredible example of a person remembering their reliance on God. It's Psalm 34, the first 8 verses. I'll read it to you. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from all my fears. Look to him and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. This poor soul cried and was heard by the Lord and was saved from every trouble. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him. I find that psalm so encouraging. It reminds me that I do rely on God, that I should rely on God. It's like the writer has remembered all the incredible parts of being a follower of God, all in one moment, and they can't help but sing their response in continual praise, even calling others to join in. to see the greatness of God and the life on offer in him through Jesus. It is a real joy to know and be known by the Lord God Almighty, to be counted as his very own, and to partake in the life and love that he offers. And I do forget that all too often, and I can make many excuses. But as well as using psalms like these to remind me, I think our epistle reading today is a helpful other option as well. I hear that it may have sounded less like an encouragement and more like a list of rules, but the key is in the first verse of that reading. It's easily missed. A line at the end of a sentence, the reason for the instruction just given. Verse 25 tells us, "For we are all members of one body." We, right along with the original recipients of this letter, are to be Christ's body, connected to each other, working together. John Wright suggests that this is to say we belong so closely to each other. We are brought together by the Holy Spirit, as verse 30 tells us. The Message version puts it, the precious gift of the Holy Spirit moving and breathing in us, making us fit for God. And we are urged not to take that for granted. It is as the body of Christ, sustained by the bread of life, that Jesus' life shines out of us, to each other and to those around. Not that any of us get to equate ourselves with Jesus, but that Jesus lives in and through us, in our communal life together as his body, enabled by the Spirit, spurring one another on. Let us hear that afresh today. The communal life we have together because of God is a gift. And the end of our epistle reading is also a rather big hint. We are made to follow the example of God, made to walk in the way of love. And to love is to give yourself to another person. This definition reflects who God is in Jesus. It's actually suggested at the end of the Gospel reading as well. Sacrificial love that gives itself for the life of the world. So we watch what God does, and then we do it as well. God is love. God loves us. We in turn love God and each other as an overflow of that. This isn't about conditional love. We're not doing these things to get to heaven. This isn't ensuring our salvation. Again, Jesus is really quite clear. God draws us to himself. No, it's not that. Have you ever noticed someone else having a trait of their family member? I don't know if you've ever had someone say, "Oh my goodness, you just look so much like Auntie Lynn or Grandpa Jack." Has anyone said those sorts of things?
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about. God draws us to himself. And simply because we are so close to God, we are children of the Almighty God. We know and trust him, and we start to sound and look like him. We imitate Christ as his body in the world, so that all of us and those around and beyond us would be able to experience something of the love God has for them. We do all we can to promote this life-giving love from the bread of life. And you see, it takes a whole body to walk. As I walk, I don't leave my foot behind. No member of Christ's body is left behind. It takes us all to walk in the way of love, working together and sharing the bread of life. So this part of the letter to the Ephesians is all about how to and how not to reflect the love that finds its source in God. There's plenty of practical advice. It reminds us to practice things that promote the fruit of the Spirit in each other. The act of speaking the truth, not letting our anger lead us into sin, helping people in need, being honest, checking that our words are helpful for building others up, practicing grace, kindness and forgiveness. All these things suggested in this letter help us cultivate the fruit of the Spirit in our life together. Thea Mirror, a creative Christian artist, suggested in her social media post just yesterday that we should keep cultivating the soil of our heart. In one of her books, she suggests that the seeds of truth from the living God are planted in our hearts. And if we've cultivated our hearts, those seeds grow. They become alive in us. So, my question is, what would it look like to live as this passage suggests? How might we walk together in the way of radical, self-giving love after the example of Christ? We dare to ask even, what would the effect of this be on others around us? Perhaps our life together would enable the hearts of those around us to be softened and prepared for the life of God living in them. Perhaps the truths that are alive in us would be planted in the hearts of others as a result. Let's take a moment to think about that. Amen.
Let us declare our faith in God.
We believe the Lord the Father, for whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please be seated. We now have our intercessions, please. Thank you.
Collect for the 10th Sunday after Trinity. Gracious Father, revive your church in our day and make her holy, strong and faithful. For your glory's sake, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Gracious God, we thank you that you are always with us, in the bad times as well as the good, the difficult as well as the easy, the sad as well as the happy. Lord of all hopefulness, hear our prayer. We thank you that you have sometimes been unsure of the way ahead. You have always been there to guide us. Though we have felt discouraged, you have offered us fresh inspiration. Though we have been in despair, you have given us hope. Lord of all hopefulness,
hear our prayer.
We thank you for the assurance this brings us, that your steadfast love never ceases, that your mercies are new every morning, that great is your faithfulness. Lord of all hopefulness,
hear our prayer.
May that conviction give us confidence in the days ahead, so that whatever problems we face, whatever disappointments we experience, whatever sorrows may befall us, we will still find reason to look forward, reason to believe in the future, and reason to hope. Lord of all hopefulness,
hear our prayer,
in the name of Christ. Amen. And a prayer for national and world leaders. Sovereign God, hear our prayer for all those to whom you have entrusted positions of leadership and responsibility. Grant them wisdom in their decisions, courage to hold fast to what is right, integrity in their dealings, and a genuine commitment to the good of all those they serve. Guide them to know and do your will for your kingdom's sake. Amen.
Amen.
And a prayer for peace in this world. Lord Jesus Christ, you came as the Prince of Peace to bring healing to all nations, to overcome hatred with love, evil with good, and darkness with light. Teach us what that means in today's complex and troubled world, where tension and unrest continue to dominate, where violence and the threat of war are all too real, and where mistrust, intolerance and prejudice still hold sway. Grant wisdom to leaders of nations, to all whose decisions will shape the future of this world, and by your Spirit break down the barriers that divide us and bring us closer to the day of your kingdom. In your name we ask it. Amen. Prayer for God who is here, there and everywhere. God beyond us, God with us, God inside us, we worship you. God outside us, God among us, God within us, we praise you. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we honor you. God of majesty, God of love, God of your power, we acknowledge you. Loving God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for all you are, all you do, and all you mean, we give you our thanks and offer our worship. In the name of Christ,
Amen.
We could be now sharing the Lord's Prayer then.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but
stand for our second hymn, All People That Are Left Do Dwell.
Amen.
Thank you to everyone watching online.